So again, good morning to everybody. My name is Tomasz Zwolinski, and I'm a product manager with RF Elements, and I'll take you through this journey today. So antennas have let me remind one thing, and that's if at any point during the presentation you have any questions, feel free to write them down into the question window in your webinar tool, and I'll answer them either during or at the end of the presentation. So back to the topic. Antennas have many so-called textbook parameters, and being a WISP, well, the question is, do you need to know about each and every one of them? Well, of course not. The answer is no, definitely not. In the WISP industry, there are only a few antenna parameters that you should really know and care about. So in general, it's fair to say that many of the antenna parameters are connected to one another, and sometimes in quite a complex way. So the parameters that are usually thought to express the ability of an antenna to deal with the interference are front-to-back ratio, side lobe level, or ETSI masks. Now, these you most likely know or at least heard about. And the one we at RF Elements believe is the most important one in terms of noise suppression is beam efficiency. And in the following slides, we will explain why. Beam efficiency is the ratio of energy contained in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates. So in other words, it tells us what part of the radiated energy is going to the main lobe. So the higher the beam efficiency is, the more energy is contained in the main lobe. In other words, where we want it to be. And vice versa, less energy is going everywhere else, or in other words, to the side lobes. Now, since side lobes do a lot of harm in the unlicensed wireless networks, beam efficiency of antennas you're using is something that's really worth knowing about. And not only actually knowing about, but also make it a decision factor when thinking about how to deal with interference. To give you a practical example, this is the radiation pattern of a generic parabolic dish antenna. So if the beam efficiency is 40%, these 40% of the power that the antenna radiates go into the main lobe. Now, how about the remaining 60%? Well, the remaining energy goes everywhere else. And since everything outside the main lobe is a side lobe, it goes into the side lobes. Note that all the side lobes are highlighted in this animation. So beam efficiency includes all the side lobes of an antenna. If you want to compare two antennas side by side in terms of side lobe performance, beam efficiency makes it extremely simple. The higher number wins. It's simple as that. So for example, the Ultrahorn had beam efficiency of 99%. So only 1% of the power it radiates is in the side lobes. And a generic dish antenna has beam efficiency 40%. So the remaining 60% of the energy it radiates is in the side lobes. So 99% is more than 40%. That's clear as the blue sky. So therefore, Ultrahorn is better antenna in terms of noise suppression. Probably the best on the market. To be fair, we should also look at the parameters you might already know. So front-to-back ratio is one of them, and many manufacturers include it into their data sheets. So let's have a small recap of front-to-back ratio. The conventional thinking about front-to-back ratio is that if it is high, it means an antenna is good for collocation. So if the antennas are back-to-back and both have high front-to-back ratio, they will not interfere with each other. The reality is that front of a ratio does not mean an antenna is good for dense collocation in every possible scenario and setting. It is simply a misconception. It is important to understand this because next time you might have a conversation about front of a ratio, you can be sure that if anyone is saying that high front of a ratio means an antenna is great for dense collocation, you know that a person is either misinformed or simply didn't go deep enough with the topic. High front of back ratio means that the backlog is small. To be more precise, the lobe pointing in the opposite direction as the main lobe, that one is small. It can also mean that a group of side lobes around the back lobe is small, depending on the definition or the way the front of back ratio was determined. So front of back ratio is easy to understand. Looking at the radiation pattern of an antenna, in this example, we show the pattern of a directional patch array. Front of back ratio is the difference between the gain of the main lobe and the back lobe, which is pointing backwards. In practice, front of back ratio is often determined based on the strongest side lobe from a plus minus 30 degree angle around the back lobe because of possible manufacturing, assembly, or material imperfections. Now, because of these imperfections, the back lobe might not be just a single lobe, but it can be fractured and divided into several minor lobes around it. And thus, this definition of front of back ratio is convention and adopted in many industries. Nevertheless, back lobe is one of many side lobes antennas used in WISP industry usually have. So if back lobe is one out of many side lobes, then it's probably not so important. Now, this is the typical error in interpretation of front to back ratio. It doesn't say anything about the other side lobes. So when two antennas are exactly back to back collocated, this is the rare kind of scenario where high front to back ratio can help to decrease interference level the radios are working with. But as I said before, the typical antenna used in WISP networks has plenty of side lobes, and the back lobe itself can be quite complex. So as soon as there are more links on a tower or the collocated antennas are not exactly back to back, you are looking at potential issues because of all the other side lobes. High front to back ratio provides no protection whatsoever in high noise environment. So for urban and suburban areas with other wireless link and links in the neighborhood or even on the same tower, front to back ratio is simply irrelevant. Now these other links may be yours or competitors. Either way, they're using similar hardware to yours, meaning their antennas are most likely also have many side lobes that create noise, which is received through the rest of the side lobes. Another parameter I wanna mention is side lobe level. Now in practical life, it is similar to front of back ratio, but let's have a look at the details. Side lobe level is the difference between the gain of the strongest side lobe and the main lobe. As such, it is more useful than the front to back ratio because at least it points out the strongest side lobe, which says about antenna performance in high noise areas to a degree. So if side lobe level is high, the strongest side lobe is close to having the gain as the main lobe, making it a poor antenna for WISP networks. The issue with side lobe level is that it doesn't talk about all the side lobes. So side lobe level is defined by the strongest side lobe, which again is only one side lobe out of many. And also it's defined at a single frequency. Now, since the side lobes are changing with frequency, the noise level also changes with them. So despite you know what the strongest side lobe is at single frequency, it's not very useful in the bigger picture, since simple switching of a channel changes everything. Side lobe level is therefore similar metric to front-to-back ratio. It tells you what the strongest side lobe is at one frequency, but nothing about the rest of the side lobes throughout the useful bandwidth of an antenna, which is the biggest issue with these two metrics. In WISP networks, all the side lobes matter. To sum it up, not all the antenna parameters are practically useful for WISP networks. It simply depends on the context the antenna is used in. And in the end, it's up to the users and mainly the manufacturers to responsibly look at each antenna parameter and evaluate whether it's useful in the framework of WISP networks or not. The conclusion for front-to-back ratio and side lobe level clearly says that these two are not so important. They tell a very limited part of the story of side lobes. You may have also heard about the ETSI masks, which to a degree, they also serve as a parameter that says how well antennas perform in terms of noise. So let's have a closer look at those. It is important to clarify that the ETSI masks consider two principal cuts of the antenna radiation pattern. So the azimuth and the elevation, obviously. So the masks consider two slices out of the whole 3D radiation pattern. In terms of frequency, the ETSI masks are observed at three frequency points, the beginning, the middle, and the end of the spectrum an antenna works in. Nevertheless, the rest of the spectrum, which is rather wide in case of WISP networks, is not included in ETSI definition. Starting with the polar plot, you may know from antenna data sheets of the antennas you're using, and redrawing it on an XY plot, the ETSI mask is a line that says that the radiation pattern should stay below the mask so that an antenna can be declared compliant with a given ETSI norm. So if it isn't, the antenna is not compliant, which is the case with this particular example we're using here. The masks are easy to understand, and to their credit, they do consider the whole 360-degree circle of the radiation pattern, but unfortunately, only two cuts of the whole 3D pattern, and that at three frequency points of the whole spectrum an antenna works in. So vast majority of the spectrum is simply not included. Now, that's why in terms of the interference suppression, they're also not very useful. So whenever you see an antenna being compliant with an ETSI form of any number, you know that it does not bring much added value in terms of suppressing noise in WISP networks. At RF Elements, we strongly believe in doing the right thing for the customer and the industry. So we looked in the textbooks as well and found out about beam efficiency, which is the most complete measure of side lobes out there. And when I say the most complete, I'm not just trying to push some marketing fluff through your ears. And in the following slides, we will clarify why. So beam efficiency is the parameter WISPs should have been looking for. It gives the right answer to the question about side lobes. So despite you might have never heard about beam efficiency before, at RF Element, we do what we believe is the best for the customer, even if it means bringing in something not considered before and which might be different from what other manufacturers are saying. So if beam efficiency is the ratio of energy contained in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates, it is also a measure of side lobes. So we can get the percentage of the energy in the side lobes by subtracting beam efficiency from the 100% of the overall energy. And we can get beam efficiency of an antenna by measurement done in an anechoic chamber, like the one you can see in this image. Now the antenna is attached to a rotary stage, which rotates in two axes, and the radiation intensity is measured. And based on the measured data, we can calculate beam efficiency. if the model of an antenna is precise enough, or if an antenna is simple, we can use simulation software to do the same thing. Obtain the radiation pattern, and based on that, we can calculate the beam efficiency. So if beam efficiency is 40%, so the 40% of the power antenna radiates goes into the main lobe. The remaining 60% therefore must be in the side lobes. Note that all the side lobes are highlighted. So beam efficiency includes all the side lobes of an antenna, not just one or a slice of a radiation pattern, but the whole 3D pattern. And it's a similar case with the sector antennas here, you can see. It's very easy to evaluate what's the amount of the energy that antenna radiates goes into the side lobe. If beam efficiency is 58%, the rest of the energy, in this case 42%, is in the side lobes. So WISPs use a wide chunk of spectrum, but in antenna textbooks, the beam efficiency is defined at a single frequency and for single polarization. Now, this is the case for most textbook parameters. And again, it is up to the user and mainly the manufacturer to consider whether one should care about the whole bandwidth or just a single frequency point. Since the computational power is much more affordable nowadays than it was in the past, we can choose whether we need a wideband or a narrowband information at will. So in WISP industry, it makes perfect sense to average beam efficiency over the whole bandwidth an antenna is working in, because WISPs use their antennas in a wide frequency band. So it only makes sense that an antenna should perform well in the whole bandwidth. So therefore, we at RF Element, we chose to extend the textbook definition of beam efficiency to a number that is the average of beam efficiency over the whole useful bandwidth of our antennas and over both polarizations. Now, by doing this, we turn the textbook definition of beam efficiency into sort of a super parameter, if you will. It is much more robust and more reliable measure of side lobe performance than the single frequency and single polarization version. So vast majority of antennas used for sectorial coverage in WISP networks are either patch arrays or horns. The patch arrays have many frequency dependent side lobes, so their beam efficiency values are around 60%, depending on the quality of the manufacturing and design. Now the RF element horns, both symmetrical and asymmetrical, have beam efficiency somewhere between 90 and 95%. So less than 10% of the radiated power is in the side lobes. Now you can see other horns in this graph as well. And this is to show that it takes considerable effort to design a horn such that its beam efficiency is high. So the stable and zero side lobe performance is not a given, but we do put a lot of effort into our antennas to achieve high beam efficiency values. Similar case is with the point-to-point antennas. The patch arrays are again at the bottom of the beam efficiency performance due to the many frequency-dependent side lobes collecting and transmitting noise, hurting in any and every WISP network. Now, dishes are somewhat better, and generally the bigger the dish, the better the beam efficiency becomes. If the antenna, I mean, that's under the condition that the antenna is carefully designed and also well manufactured. Now, with any antenna, though, the compromises accepted at the design stage cannot be compensated by the manufacturing quality, since the real world results with the antenna design are best at best approaching the design based on simulation results. Yeah. So what is interesting here, though, is the ultra horn. So its beam efficiency is 99%. So over the whole bandwidth of operation and over both polarizations, the beam efficiency of ultra horn is practically perfect. Only 1% of the RF signal is in the side lobes. So if you ever wondered if Ultrahorn was worth the extra cash compared to any kind of dish antenna, you have a very clear answer here. With 99% of beam efficiency, it's probably the best performing antenna on the market in terms of noise suppression. Beam efficiency tells you everything about sidelobe performance. The higher it is, the better antenna performs. So there you have it. I mean, ditch the front to back ratio, ditch side lobe level or ETSI masks, and focus on the beam efficiency of an antenna when dealing with noise. Not only is the beam efficiency the most complete measure of side lobes, but it's also extremely robust measure of side lobes because of the averaging over the frequency, bandwidth, and both polarizations. Since it rarely happens that a wireless link is situated in a completely isolated place, the interference is present almost everywhere. So the noisier the environment and the more important the beam efficiency of an antenna becomes, because the higher the beam efficiency, the better the noise isolation. So in the following section, So the shortest practical implication of high beam efficiency is that, you know, the antenna has low side lobes, which results into a good SNR the radio is working with, and in the end, it means higher throughput. So we can sum up the effect of the beam efficiency of high beam efficiency of antennas into one statement. It equals higher throughput. So in a sector with no other links in the area, you don't mind the side lobes really, but as the number of sectors grows, the side lobes cause the noise floor to rise. So higher noise floor equals to lower throughput. The beam efficiency of patchery sectors is on the order of 60%. So the 40% of the energy is in the side lobes. And these side lobes collect and transmit interference to other links within yours, but also competitors' network, obviously. So low beam efficiency equals to lower throughput and consequentially more unsatisfied customers. Low beam efficiency of dish antennas works in a similar way. The side lobes collect the noise from its surroundings and transmit it to all neighboring links. So whether it's a backhaul link or a distant narrow sector, the beam efficiency around 45% means low throughput in high noise areas. Replacing the low beam efficiency patch array sector by horn antennas with beam efficiency up to 99%, the noise level in the urban and high density areas is effectively avoided. So because high beam efficiency means no side lobes, and no side lobes means no interference, resulting into a higher throughput. It's as simple as that. So addressing the most pressing problem of WISP networks becomes much more straightforward. Only one advice here. Use antennas with high beam efficiency. High beam efficiency equals high throughput. The radio manufacturers are, of course, also trying to help with the noise, of course. So the GPS synchronization, which ensures that the radios in your network transmit and receive at the same time, protects you from self-interference. But it does not protect you from the side lobes of the competitor's antennas. So high beam efficiency antenna ensures that you don't have to worry about the interference at all. It does not receive it. So you don't need to try to deal with interference in the first place. So beam efficiency is a very practical antenna parameter, where before the discussion about the side lobes was so sort of limited to, you know, the comparisons of type like, okay, this antenna has many side lobes, this antenna has little side lobes, or this antenna has, this antenna doesn't have. Beam efficiency provides a number from 0 to 100%, which makes it super easy to compare side lobe performance. So now you know that front to back ratio and or side lobe level are the parameters that are not so important nor useful in WISP industry because they only consider one side lobe out of many an antenna might have. So beam efficiency includes all the side lobes, which makes it very useful metric. Including all the side lobes removes any sort of ambiguity. You can be sure that this metric is reliable. And always ask whether a parameter is single frequency or wideband. In WISP industry, wideband is simply a must because the spectrum is shared by many, and therefore wideband performance is simply vital. So RF element addition to the beam efficiency definition is to average over both polarizations and whole antenna bandwidth. Now you cannot do better than that, period. That's why beam efficiency is the ultimate measure to judge antennas by in WISP industry. And it is a tool in your hands to make a better decision for your business. So please use it and keep asking for it. To make it easy for you, we added beam efficiency of our antennas into all our data sheets. Now we're a transparent manufacturer and want to provide our customers with the information that is important for them. So education is also an important part of our awareness activities. It is one out of many of our first in the WISP industry. Now things that we at RF Elements can put on display is that our idea is that only an educated customer can make qualified decisions. Now we're also very open about myth busting because there are many myths out there and misconceptions about all kinds of wireless concepts that consequentially can create a lot of problems in WISP networks. You've probably already noticed that we have our online forum called rflab.com. If you haven't, it's a forum where you can, it's the most direct way to contact us. You can ask questions about our products or search through the questions that have been already asked. There's a lot of recordings of webinars such as this one and also other recordings. And of course, we can find us also on the social, other social media platforms. So eventually, just a trademark disclaimer so that it's clear that we're using third parties' trademarks only to reference compatibility with our products.